So good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the first session of PerMed webinar series. Today, Alfonso Valencia from BSC is going to present an introduction to PerMedCoE, the HPC Exascale Center of Excellence for Personalized Medicine in Europe. My name is Daniel Tomás López. I am involved in PerMedCoE on behalf of EmboDBI, and I am going to host this webinar. Before starting, I would like to make you aware that this webinar is being recorded, including the questions and answers section, and the recording will be disseminated afterwards through YouTube and our website. After the presentation, we will have time for questions. So please use the Q&A button in your Zoom panel to write your questions during the webinar. Let me now introduce our speaker. Alfonso Valencia, PerMedCoE Technical Coordinator, is a Spanish biologist, ICREA professor, current director of the Life Science Department at the Barcelona Supercomputing Center, BSC, and the Spanish National Bioinformatics Institute. As computational biologist, the focus of his work is the mechanistic understanding of biological systems, including cancer and other diseases, with a combination of bioinformatics, network biology, and machine learning approaches. His group has developed systems in the area of protein structure prediction, protein interactions and protein networks, system biology, text and data mining, with applications in epigenetics, cancer genomics, and disease comorbidity. All these activities converge into the general topic of personalized medicine, with particular interest in the interface with artificial intelligence and high-performance computing. So now I hand over to Alfonso for his presentation.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Thanks for organizing this, hosting this series of webinars. Let me see if I can share my screen. So it is a pleasure to start the series introducing the HPC Exascale Center of Excellence in Personalized Medicine. What I have prepared is a general introduction with some motivation of why we think this activity is important and why we started and why we see the main challenge and how we are facing them at the different levels from more computational to more biological. Let me start with a little bit of a philosophical approach and it's going to be short, don't worry. So I took it from this paper, can be from any other reference. We are dealing in molecular biology in general, with these issues regarding mechanistic understanding. What are we going to achieve? How we are facing the appreciation of the parts, molecules, genes, et cetera, the processes, pathways, signaling cascades, in a way that we can understand how they work, what is the causal mechanism, how things are triggered, and how they work. That goes into being able to understand and to be able to model these processes, being able to do predictions based on these the reasons that we find and deduce that are connecting parts and processes, and being able to explore these in different conditions. If we really understand the process, we should be able to model the process. That's a very general motivation about modeling. The reality of what we are doing in general in genomics, as you are surely aware of, is this type of example. These are random samples from what is called in general gene set enrichment analysis, what is the key element in most of the high throughput molecular biology approaches. A molecular profile of different type with different technologies can be obtained. There is a reference that can be pathways or annotations of gene functions with gene ontology. And then a number of statistical operations, that is what is the jet set enrichment analysis is based on, are used to deduce how this overexpress of mutated genes correspond to are enriched in a given pathway or the other way around, how a given pathway is enriched in these mutated or overexpressed genes. The level of, and this is, and we all have done these type of papers, that's at the end of a study of a number of cases. The conclusion will be that the number of pathways are enriched and they are probably related with the process, and our level of understanding or molecular level of mechanistic interpretation will be referring to this data saying, okay, now I think that this process is related with this pathway and this is important because this and that, and there will be some experiments to confirm that. This is fine, it has been very successful, but at the level of explanation of molecular understanding of the process is, I would say, very simple. And it's really not providing more than a general statistical interpretation of the data. We thought that maybe we can do better than that, that we should be able to provide something more than a general statistical interpretation of the data in terms of potentially related pathways or gene ontology functions. So this is the idea, being able to take molecular data, in this case, I'm representing single cell data, dividing a given expressed tumor in different cell types based on the expression profiles of different cells. Being able to take this information to deduce models of how each one of these cells is working, and each one of them will have a different input information because they are different, correspond to different cell types. At the same time, they have different levels of gene expression, so for their physiological status is different. We should be able to model this process for each one of the cells, and at the same time, we should be able to model the process for all the cells interacting. In this case, it's a tumor, could be an organoid. So there are these two levels, what is going inside the cell and what is going on between in the tissue, in the contact between different cells. The overall aim, if we put this in relation with the previous slices, we will aiming to replace the current bioinformatics method, the GCA typical statistical approximations, by mechanistic models that will provide a better and more precise mechanistic description of the process, and at the same time, a more fine-grained description of the testable hypothesis. Will not be just pointing to a pathway that is enriched, will be pointing to specific points in the set of pathways in the cell that are critical for a given model. So providing better models that will provide a more mechanistic, a better type of mechanistic interpretation of the underlying biology. That's the very general aim, that's the philosophical approach. This is what we were thinking about in terms of where we want to go in biology in the next years. To do that, we started this Center of Excellence, trying to do these two things, models of modeling what is going inside the cell and what is going on between cells, tissues or organs or tumors in this case, as is represented. At the same time, it's good to keep this in perspective. The European Commission started a number of centers of excellence, three of them in biology. Bioxcel, that is working at the atomic level, is doing molecular dynamics and calculations in proteins, DNAs, drugs. So this is the atomic level. Combiomed is working more at the high resolution level, at the upper resolution level. So in this case, these are models of organs, the model of the health function, including mechanistics and electrostatics, and developed by Mariana Vázquez at the PhD as part of the Combiomed efforts. So we are with the third Center of Excellence in biology, we are sitting somewhere in between these two levels, between the atomistic level and the organ level, providing, I would say, the intermediate part, that is the one that is more proper of molecular biology, with this cell level type of simulations. That's the goal, and this is how the biology landscape at the level of the high-performance computing centers and the center of excellence fit together. So let me repeat this again. What we are trying to do in PerMed COE is to develop models of different cell types, being able to simulate individual behavior of cells, individual behavior of cells, and at the same time combine these at the level of cell-cell interactions and the interaction with the environment, and then using this model, as in this example that we'll enter into details later, using this model, for example, to simulate the consequences of drug administration, obviously combining this with real data, feeding this with real data, checking this with providing hypotheses, and then checking them again with real experimental data on real biological systems. Disclaimer, before going into more details, we know that simulations are not real. That simulations are a representation of reality. My previous work was in the Spanish National Cancer Research Center, so I'm very much aware that this nice representation of blue, green, yellow, and brown, red and brown spheres, in which we try to simulate a tumor, is not like a real tumor, and this is just a picture of a real tumor. The question obviously is not that we are reproducing all the details. The question is if we are reproducing enough details of the model to be of practical utility, if it is able to reproduce some critical behaviors and produce reasonable hypotheses that will lead to more targeted experiments. So there's always an interesting discussion of what are the limits of modeling and what is the resolution we need to have to solve biological problems. So this is my motivation and why we started this adventure in a center of excellence in personalized medicine. What I'm going to do is to go through these five points, the computational challenge in terms of what are the methods that we have to do this type of approach. All these methods has to be converted into something that can be run at a high throughput level if we want to be able to reproduce complex models of complex systems. What is the challenge at the level of software, even if we have methods that are able to run in a high-performance computing? How we integrate these methods, so this is what I call the software challenge. And with all that, how we address the biological questions. And I'm going to show you a few results of what we already start achieving with the initial models, as more than as an example than nothing else. And then I have a couple of slides to tell you how we are trying to organize ourselves for addressing these technical and scientific challenges. So let's start with the first one. So there are many, the field of molecular simulations at the cellular level has been there for years, and there are many different groups and approaches, interesting and valid, that can be used, has been used for that and have been published in this area. In some point, we have to choose a sort of minimal set of software for the first phase of the center of excellence, thinking that they will cover within the main areas and then in the future being able to expand the lessons learned on how to move this software to a high performance computer environments and how to integrate them to the many other pieces of software that may be complementary, needed, or alternative to this one. So for the, we divided the intracellular simulations in three levels, metabolic pathways. For that, we are collaborating with the University of Luxembourg, the lab of Reinhard Schneider. They have a component of COBRA called COBREXA, Cobra is a very large suite of software dedicated to the simulation of metabolic pathways. For the simulation of signaling pathways, that will be the second category, we choose MAPOS, developed by the lab of Barillot in the Curie in Paris. And this is representing signaling pathways and a way of simulating these using Boolean unprobabilistic Boolean probabilistic models. For the additional level of regulation, that is at the level of gene expression, we are collaborating with a group of Julio Saez Rodriguez in the University of Heidelberg. He has different approaches to that. The first one we choose, and now we are interested in other ones, but the one I have here is CERN-OPT, that is a system for adapting to expression data existing maps of gene regulation in a way that it can reproduce specific intracellular characteristics. These are the intracellular level software for intracellular level simulations. For the intercellular level simulations, cell-cell interactions and cell-environment interaction, we decided to go with PhysiCell, at least for the first phase of the project. PhysiCell was originally developed by Paul McLean in the University of Indiana. It's an open software, and now has a reasonably large community of open software, developing open software with different pieces around PhysiCell. On the process of doing all that, we are also working in a combination of PhysiCell with MAPOS that we call PhysiBOS. And I will show you some results on that. That will be a first, I would say the first level integration of signaling pathways with intercellular simulations. So just to go give you some more information about the components. COBRA stands for constraint-based reconstruction and analysis. So essentially what it's doing is taking the known metabolic pathways, adapting them to different data, input data, and solving these, what is known, the flux balance analysis equations in a way that can find solutions to a given initial state in terms of the stability and output of the metabolic pathways. Needless to say that the area of metabolic simulation has been there for quite some time. It's more than a proven area with including commercial applications in biotechnology, particularly, and applications that goes from very complex models to more simple ones, simulations of at the level of complete bacterial metabolism, so the particular pathways, and in many cases related with the possible interventions in terms of mutations or intervention with drugs, and also controlling the type of flux and the type of products that are produced by the metabolic system done at the level of, predicted at the level of model. This is called genome scale metabolic models because they are trying to encompass the genomic information during this particular for a given model, and there are different versions of the software to do that. And as I say, we are using this, let's call it version, developed by the University of Luxembourg. The MAPOS is a particular implementation of Boolean networks in which a stochastic component has been introduced. The stochastic component is particularly important for us because this is the way in which we can introduce the variation between different cell types and use as an input expression data, for example, reflecting different states for different cells. Otherwise, with a given Boolean model, all the cells will behave in the same way. Introducing the stochasticity in the modeling, different cells will be able to acquire different behaviors along the trajectories. Cell and Opt is the last piece of software. It's the one that is more, still more at the research level. It's logic-based models for signal transduction, the signaling pathways and regulation pathways. Again, this is based on existing maps of, in the case, EGF, TNF, signaling with the known connections between the different components of the signaling pathway, and the work done in the tool, or the work that the tool is doing, is creating the pipelines to be able to incorporate the readouts from expression of our phosphoproteomics, and being able to adapt the flows on the system and the working of the signaling cascade, the model signaling cascade, to the input data, following the system model and simulating the logical conditions connecting the different components of the system. As I say, we are using other adding other tools as of from Julio, complementing OPT. In this case, is Carnival, that stands for casual reasoning for network identification using integral value programming. Again, this idea trying to predict perturbations in a given model with a given system, in this case, at the level of gene expression regulation. So these are predicted expression regulation pathways based on predicted transcription factor activities. So with this component, we have the basic intracellular system. The intracellular system is based, as I already said, in Fischer cell. Fischer cell is a pretty large piece of software or system that is doing this simulation of cells based on an agent-based system. The positions of the cells are determined specifically, and the system can allow, like in the figure, the inclusion of different cell types, the operations of cells dividing or dying, in a way that in the example, this will be a tumor growing with more cells appearing in the surface and making the tumor grow, but also cells dying in the internal part of the tumor by lack of oxygen. And it's important that all the simulation is done in the context of an environment, and the environment is represented with a diffusion transport solver that is giving a as realistic as possible idea of how the different components, oxygen, and et cetera, are feeding to the cells. And as in the example, at different levels, there will be more access to the nutrients in the outside of the tumor than in the inside of it. Again, not going to enter into that. As in the case of metabolic modeling, agent-based modeling has been around for quite a while. There are agent-based simulations of many different processes, not only obviously in molecular biology, but in many other areas of engineering. And indeed, many of these systems are already in use in industry. So it's, in this sense, it's a well-proven technology. There are different ways of implementing agent-based models. In the case, the one we are using, Fischer-Cell, is representing these overlapping spheres. There are other ways of representing the structure of the cell interactions. And in this case, we think that from a biological point of view, these overlapping spheres is a good initial approximation. Again, the current simulations of Fischer cells are very nice, beautiful to see them, representing different cell types and approaching behaviors that are not at the macro point of view. In this case, was this type of growing tumor and then collapsing by being attacked by a drug or by the immune system. So, as I said, this is a choice. There are obviously many other methods that are effective in all these areas. We selected the ones that were in our initial approximation, ready to go to a phase of integration and with collaborators, and also the ones that are suitable and in a sense in the need of being scaled up in a way that they can run to a larger volumes to be able to do more complex simulations. One of the developments of the Center of Excellence is an observatory in which we are monitoring other developments in the field, preparing for the future, because obviously our intention is not by no means to be only working only in these initial pieces of software. We are planning in the future to extend to other software that will cover or replace or complement some of the current approaches, some of the current software. The high performance computing challenge. The high performance computing challenge for us is maybe different than for other areas of science and engineering. These methods are very good, but they have been developed by computational biology groups. They are initially designed to run in a small scale and doing relatively simple simulations of relatively simple systems. And what we want to do in terms of simulating a large number of cells, each one of them with their own system, requires taking this software, reshaping this software, preparing them to be able to run in high-performance computing facilities. So essentially, what we are saying is that this software is fine, but need to be reorganized, if you want to put it that way. So the way we see that is that we are collaborating with experts in high-performance computing that are talking to the developers of each of these pieces of software, analyzing the software and thinking how to scale this to be able to really run in many threads in a high throughput manner. Something that is very much in the spirit of the high performance computing centers and in the Center of Excellence is that these efforts in scaling up software will also be connected with the efforts to develop new computers. So the way we see that is that we talk as biologists or computational biologists to the experts in high performance computing to scale up the software. They will learn, or they are learning about what we need in terms of computing and what is specific about the things that we do that are different from other areas of science and engineering. And these lessons are then transmitted by them to the ones that are developing the new generation of computers and processors. So this is what is called co-design, and we have this roadmap of co-design in which we are doing in two phases using the HPC experts as, I would say, intermediary between the computational biologists and the designers of the new generation of computers. And this is, I would say, very high up in the current agenda of the European efforts to get to stand by yourself in computing at all levels, from the development of the new generation of processors to being able to produce our own supercomputers. I'm not going to say more about that, but you're interested in, I think it's a very interesting scientific and political discussion. So I give you two examples. So we are collaborating with POP. POP is one other center of excellence led by the Barcelona Supercomputing Center. And they are a sort of a transversal center of excellence. What they do is to collaborate with the other center of excellence, helping them to analyze their software and to propose ways of speeding up the software, making them to work not only faster, but also to be able to work more in a more parallel way. This is a very apparently simple operation, but with a lot of operations by changing the libraries, one of the libraries that PhysiCell is using. We managed to get a speed up of 4 times and to be able to run effectively in 40 threads. What opened the door to make an effective use, a much effective use of the computational resources, being able to do to expand all simulations to more threads and to take more more cores on the supercomputing facilities. The other implementation that is already done, this is the work in collaboration with the IMSA support of the Barcelona Supercomputing Center. Gurav has already published this his development as part of the activity of the PerMed-COE and what he called BOFPM. This is a new version of the specific component of physical cell that is responsible of the fluid dynamic simulation, so the of the simulation of the environment. Again, this is a very expensive component to calculate, and this was a boundary for the a wall against this physical simulation we're hitting. Now with these new implementations, the software is scaling up very nicely, and we can do much larger simulations without without entering in a stuck situation during the simulations. So this physical we are going forward this physical MPI implementation that is already allowing us to do much much larger simulations in a more stable way, and this is only the upgrade of one of the components. This is still not touching the proper cell-cell interactions, only the components related with the environment. So these are two examples. There is more work going on, but that's the two things that are already, I would say, achieved in terms of scaling into different collaborations with high-performance computing experts. Now, the next challenge from the point of view of the developments is the software challenge, and this is one that is very proper of computational biology, of the infrastructures for computational biology. So even if these pieces of software will be scaled up and running nicely on our Marienstrom computer, still we are facing with the problem of how to fit this, from a biology point of view. We want to have a complete path. We want to be able to tell biologists, here you can input your expression data, single cell data, for example, and the simulations will run smoothly without you having to touch the components. That goes into the domain of Dockers and workflows. What we want to do is to have all the different components that are required to complete the chain of events that goes from the input genomic data, input of the structure of the networks, et cetera, the modeling of the different parts, running the supercomputer, and producing results that are provided in a way that can be understood by the users. Thus, requires developing the components as independent software that can be used in different systems. In the current technologies are Dockers, and putting this together in a sensible way, in a way that the components can be interoperated, and this goes into the area of workflows and workflow managers. And as illustrated in the figure for the use cases, we'll talk about use cases in a minute, the use cases that we selected are responding to different biological questions that will require a different order, a different number and type of building blocks, Dockers, and a different connections, developing different workflows to solve the different questions. Examples, this one, for example, we get some gene candidates. These come from a list of genes obtaining from some experiments. At the same time, we get raw data, will be single cell profiling. All this has to will provide some kind of patient-based input, and we can do this in parallel for many different cases, for many different patients, with patient-specific data, a general simulation simulation itself is the same for all of them. The patient, the data, patient-specific data come from the different experiments, and then we can run these simulations in parallel for different cases or under different conditions and produce something that then can be analyzed at the statistical level. Different results or different models under different conditions. And the discussion is how to do this in a better possible way. And the challenge, obviously, here is to combine software that runs in a more standard way, with software that requires a lot of memory and a lot of capacity, typically the analysis of genomic information, with the simulations that are already running in these HPC facilities. And combining these different levels requires the integration, very likely, of different type of workflow managers that can be combined between them. The workflows managers specialize in the, and this is a case of comps, specialize in the work in HPC, being able to distribute the task in high-performance computers. Another workflow managers, Nextflow, for example, will be more specialized in the type of tasks that we are using in genomic instead. This means that we rely on orchestrators that will be able not only to develop these to develop these operations, and for each one of the tasks, choose the appropriate level of granularity of the dockers and choose the specific workflow managers that will be more appropriate for each one of the tasks, and then develop these workflows. And that's the conceptual view for one of the use cases. Well, there is, put it like that, at the level of the software challenge, we are part of the community, and I can refer to the Elixir community developing these technologies of workflows, the repository of workflows, the technologies, the different technologies for different workflows, managers. But in our case, the task of being able to integrate the high-performance computing calculations in the workflows makes things a little bit more challenging than for other for other areas. The biological challenge, obviously, is phrased in terms of use cases. So we are concentrating in four different use cases, representing different levels of complexity at the same time. The one I have been implicitly referring to is the use of single-cell data to simulate the evolution of tumors based on omics single cell data, omics data, expression data, the level of single cell resolution, and imaging data. The second level we are developing is simulations in which we are mixing many different cell types in a dynamic way. And the use case here, as demanded by the times, is COVID-19, in which we are developing this multi-scale modeling, in which we are integrating two very different entities, obviously the virus and the virus and the patient system. So these are different cell types corresponding to humans, and then the viral different cell types as a different cell type, if you want. And the other two use cases correspond to a different type of data. These are of patients, of cell lines, or animal models, for which we have RNA-seq data, not at the cell level resolution, but at the bulk data type of resolution. But at the same time, we have information for many different individuals, many different patients, or different cell lines, or different animal models. The case we have we are following for cancer diagnosis is chronic lymphocytic leukemia, for which there is already a very large collection of omic data at the level of genomes, and also at the level of expression data. The second case is drug synergies for cancer treatment. This is more related with cell lines, a large collection of cell lines that has been already treated with different drugs, and this the response at the level of expression at the level of output or consequence for the cells has been followed, and then there are a number of experiments in synergies between drugs, and the challenge is being able to predict the consequences of this combination of drugs for the survival of the cell lines. At the same time, at these different levels, we are going to use different combinations of software. Some of them will be using more gene expression data and simulation of the gene expression control. Others will be using more metabolic information or signaling cascades. Some of them will require drug-drug interactions. For the drug-drug interaction, we don't need cell-cell interaction because this is done on cell lines. For the tumor evolution, we obviously need the simulations at the level of intercellular interaction. So this corresponds, therefore, to different combinations of the software and also different type of input data. With this, we cover at least a good part of the combinations or the possible combinations in terms of biological cases. So this is what we try to do. I already mentioned this PhysiBoss combination of PhysiCell and MapBoss. So this is making simulations of signaling pathways inside cells and then simulating what happened in the context of multiple cell interactions. And what we will try to do is then to fit this simulation with, for example, in this case, different treatment with tumor necrosis factor at different types times, and then follow how many cells are alive, how many of them are time from necrotic necrosis or from apoptosis. So we can do this because it's a dynamic system. We can follow the simulations along the time, and then obviously we can confront this with experiment done in an experimental system. So that will be examples of that. Here we are simulating this treatment with TNF in different regimes. The only one that is in the panel D, the one with the is in red, is the only one that by organizing the treatment, the pulse of TNF in a particular regime, at the end of the after some time, the number of cells dying is more than the one of cells surviving. So in principle, this will be an indication that the tumor is dying. According to these simulations, the other treatments, there are more cells surviving, so they are not killing the tumor. Obviously, this is done in parallel with the experiments in a way that in the first phase, you adjust your simulations to what is known, and then you start predicting new cases, new treatments, and then this new treatment can be experimentally challenged. The use case of COVID, again, I don't want to go into a lot of details. There have been already simulations from PhysiCell about the SARS-CoV-2 infection, designing things at the cell level with different cell type and trying to reproduce the interaction between the epithelial cells, the viral infection, and the reaction of the immune system. What we try to add to that using this PhysiBoss implementation is to add to the PhysiCell simulations, internal simulations of the behavior of the cells in different stages respect to the virus, in a way that we can simulate different mutations of the human cells or of the viruses. And then implementing these simulations in the epithelial cells that are infected by the virus. So without going into a lot of detail, because there's still preliminary work, this is an exploration of the what we call wild type, so a panel of epithelial cells infected with the virus under different these type of simulations, in which the essentially the infection is progressing and the virus is spreading. FID are mutations simulating a mutation in the human cells that can to some extent prevent the invasion of the virus. The virus tend to accumulate. maybe more interesting are the mutations, the MKO, are the mutations in the virus, and these are could be simulated in different strains of the virus, for example, or an attack of a drug. And in this case, if there are enough viruses with the mutation, these 95% of the viruses are affected by the mutation, then there is a clear accumulation of the virus inside the cell, cannot go outside, cannot spread the infection. So that's, again, this is still ongoing work, but this is the type of result that we aim to have out of these simulations. These are just to show a picture of that. These are the two simulations running for two conditions, the wild type conditions, in which the virus is attacking the epithelial cells in blue, and then the immune cells, T cells, and getting crazy and destroying everything. And in the other panel is the opposite situation, with many of the viruses are already mutated, then they are not able to infect, they are able to infect the tissue, but not to spread the infection. And then the situation is sort of under control. So again, take this just as ways of illustrating the what can be done with the simulations. I think it's worth noticing the numbers. We are talking about simulations with the right panel, 2,800 agents, and the current time for the simulation is 5 days. So that tells you about the need of speeding up all this process if we want to go to more realistic simulations with two orders of magnitude more agents and being able to do this in a reasonable short time, trying many different conditions. So we are facing, as I think it's clear, two simultaneous problems. We need to speed up each one of the simulations. 5 days is too much time, and 2,000 are too few agents. At the same time, we have to be able to use the computational capacities to go in parallel and do and try many different conditions, for example, many different mutants of the virus in this case. So that's the type of simulations we are. This is just the FISI cell is producing pretty pictures. So this is a pretty picture of FISI cell. This is a tumor growing, and then there is an immune response and attacking the tumor and exiting the tumor from the outside to the inside. We also see that the inside of the tumor cells are dying because they don't have enough access to oxygen in principle. And the tumor is getting disintegrated by the invasion from the immune cells that are attacking the tumor. So this is a robust immune response to the tumor until it will end up with the full thing disappearing. So that's my quick run on the software we selected to do that. They need to move this software to high performance computing level, being able to do more effective simulations, being able to integrate these simulations with the current work in genomics, in a way that at the end of the day, the user will be able to run directly simulation from their genomic data, and all the work in workflows is going in this direction of being able to provide an integrated piece of software to be useful to the end users. And then I show you some of the initial pieces of examples of the type of problems and the type of simulations that we are already developing and aiming to develop in a large scale, combined with experimental counterpart experimental input data and experimental data for the assessment of the results. The organizational challenge, so these are the groups participating in PerMedCoE, in this first phase of PerMedCoE. The idea of the Center of Excellence is that they will be assessed after the first period and then apply again, but then the idea is that they will be continued in time, because it doesn't make sense to develop this activity, they cannot be maintained in time. So I'm not going to read all the names of the groups. It's a very large collaboration. There are two, the CFC in Finland and the Barcelona Supercomputing Center in Barcelona. We are the host of two of the new Exascale computers that are together with the one in Italy are the first, for the first time, represented large investment of the European Commission in buying computational capacity and establishing these centers of high performance computing. So I'm very happy to have the CFC as a partner. So we are representing probably the only two centers in Europe that has a strong biological component in their development. I already mentioned some of the other partners that are bringing pieces of software and collaborating in upgrading this software to HPC levels and also in the development of the use cases. Finally, I want to mention in particular Jose Carbonell and Ana Montague, that are two senior postdocs in the group that are the ones that are, I would say, running most of the activities and organizing many of the activities of the PerMedCoE. And obviously the other groups at the BSC that are developing other technical parts of the project. I already mentioned the data scale efforts and the upgrading HPC, the work in parallelizing components, and also the efforts of, and this brings me to the next slide, I focus the talk obviously in the scientific and technical components of the PerMedCoE. At the end of the day, for the Center of Excellence, this is only one part of the activity. The other part of the activity is equally important, is to be able to integrate with the communities, and this means with the other HPC centers, with the other Center of Excellence, building a sustainability model. I already mentioned that the intention of the Center of Excellence is to be running beyond these initial 3 years, and very important for us are the training activities. If we develop all these workflows integrating simulations, are not just for the sake of doing that, it's for them to be used, and then the training component and the outreach component are fundamental if we want to be able to involve biologists and biomedical scientists in the use of these facilities. So even if I'm not expanding today on these two components, I think they are essential for the future of these type of activities. So with this, I want to finish. So we put all these cellular simulations, all the high performance computing efforts, trying to build a sustainable roadmap for exascale in biology, personalized medicine, this type of molecular biology. We want to be an entry point for this type of simulation, so in a way that we serve the community by providing instruments to be able to do their own simulations, and then connecting the work of high-performance computing and simulations with the work and the work of omic research and genomics in a way that all the amazing data that we are collecting, and I mentioned a number of times single cell data, can really be understood at the level of mechanistic models, and this can serve in the research, biomedical research or biological research. So with this I finish. I'm happy to have questions, thank you for attending the webinar.
Thank you very much, Alfonso. Thank you very much for your presentation. Yeah, just remember to remind the attendees that you can write your questions using the Q&A button. We can use the last 5 minutes for some questions. So we have already some questions that have arrived. Hi, nice talk. you said that the focus of PerMed-COE are four different tools. Have you planned to expand this list and consider other tools?
Yeah, absolutely. So we started something that we call an observatory. So it's a scouting other applications. So we mean reading papers, but more than that, contacting people that we know are very active in this field and they are leaders in the field of molecular cellular level simulations, with the plan of including other tools and transferring all what we are learning about how to scale up the software. So two things, helping them to scale up the software and at the same time providing the technology to integrate these as pieces of a puzzle in a way that if someone prefers this software, we should be able to provide the pieces in which different type of software can be combined in a rational way. So yes, absolutely.
Okay. And we have another question. Will your workflows and containers be available for the public? Are they specific of your HPC clusters?
No, that's the beauty of the technology. This is very much developed along the lines of the Elixir infrastructure for bioinformatics. All the components will go to the Elixir repository of Dockers and develop in a way that is developed and tested to be interoperable with the other components and tested in different workflow managers from different specifications. There are interesting questions that I would say is still early to know how they are going to solve. As the computational infrastructures in Europe are evolving and we are going to have a far wider diversity of technologies, how we are going to be able to adapt the software to different HPC facilities is a question. Already GPUs are representing a challenge for the software. So I think that these are, while I'm sure that the components will be working in any computer, if they're going to be able to scale it up to work in all the different architectures, that's going to be a very significant question that we have to address in the future.
Okay, we have another question. Scaling up performance of codes is hard work. How many cores do your applications scale to now, and what will you need for the exascale?
No, I don't, honestly speaking, I don't think that we are going to be at the exascale level. Exascale is a lot of computing power, and I don't think that we are going to be there. It's impossible, at least right now, to imagine that any of this software is going to require the interconnected capacity at the exascale level. Indeed, it is very difficult to imagine right now any software that will require by itself the full exascale machine with all this capacity. Certainly, we need more than what we have. We have been as a challenge. We have been discussing this 1,000 million cell simulation. This will require a lot of capacity, a lot of computational capacity, and I'm not right now able to say how much it will be because we are still in this order of the less than 100 threads running simultaneously. That will mean that we are not going to get to the end capacity of an exascale machine, I'm sure of that, but I'm sure that we can have many simulations in parallel. We will need many simulations in parallel to simulate many different conditions and many different input parameters. So for us, and this is an ongoing discussion at many different levels, the way of understanding that is that we need two things, the depth in computing and the wide computing, being able to do many simulations and these simulations being more intense in terms of a number of cores being used. And I think this is going to be is not only something specific in biology, this is going to be true for most of the simulations. There are very, you know, very few cases that will be for which an argument can be a different argument can be made.
Okay, maybe we can just very quickly, the last question that we have, that it's, thanks for a nice talk. For your most challenging simulations, how many servers have you maximally connected with one another?
For servers, it's something else, it's a different quantity. The largest simulations, I showed you some of the results that we have right now, are with this, I would say it's less than 100 threads. And this is run in a, taking a capacity that I would say is equivalent to, I would say around 48 cores.
Okay, so thank you very much for your time, Alfonso, and to all the attendees for participating. And I would just like to finish with the slide that we have informing you of the upcoming webinars in October and November, where we will learn about the tools that we are using, PerMed-COE, Cobrexa, and Mabos to start with. And you can already sign up for the webinars in the PerMed website. So thank you all for attending, and see you in the next PerMed webinar. Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.